Good morning, everybody, and welcome to our IDSA webinar on usage control and enforcement in the international data spaces. My name is Sebastian Steinbuch. I am the lead architect of the IDSA. Today, Christian Jung, head of the Department Security Engineering at the Fraunhofer Institute for Experimental Software Engineering, and Andreas Eitel, senior scientist at the Fraunhofer Institute for Experimental Software Engineering, and also Gerd Boss from the Fraunhofer ISAC, we'll have a webinar on usage control and enforcement in the IDS. As you know, the international data spaces establish a trusted peer-to-peer network to foster the data economy and usage policies. Usage control, data provenance tracking, and data sovereignty is in the heart of the IDS and approaches of the IDS. For more details of the IDS, get in contact with us or listen to the IDSA by the webinars that are available on our YouTube channel. If you are going to join our webinar today, you can ask your questions afterwards in the questions and answers block. You can ask directly in the questions and answers block, or just write down your questions in the chat. If you join our webinar on YouTube, just comment below or come back to us via email or give us a call. If you like this webinar, just hit the like button below. Christian, Andreas, and Gerd, I'm very happy to have you here today for your webinar on usage control and enforcement in the IDS. So please go ahead.
Thank you, Sebastian, for the introduction. My name is Christian Jung, and I will start with the presentation and will first present you the content of the presentation. I will shortly present the presenter today of the webinar, then talk about data usage control in general, what we are doing in the area of data usage control at our institute, and then specifically for data usage control in the IDS. With the two parts, language for the specification of data sovereignty and the technical implementation of data sovereignty. That means how you can technically enforce data sovereignty. And we will end with a summary, further information, and the contact persons. The presenters in our institute, I'm at Fraunhofer IEC since 2009. I'm heading the security engineering department, and I'm also heading the competence center for data usage control. Most of our activities in the area of data usage control are in my department, but we have also some cross-cutting activities like user experience and architecture. That means we are much broader at our institute. That's why we have also this Compass Center for Data Usage Control. My research fields are context-aware security, where I'm doing a PhD at the moment, data usage control, of course, and the intelligence of security solutions to make security solutions intelligent instead of having not so nice solutions maybe. Andreas Eitel joined us in 2013. He's a security engineer at my department. And of course, his research fields are also data usage control, but also the decision engine and the policy evaluation, how you can optimize the decision engine, for example, and also security auditing and network penetration tests. I will have a short look at our institute. We have been founded in 1969. Our headquarters is in Kaiserslautern. We have about 155 FTEs, much more heads, of course, but the FTEs is about 155. And we provide solutions which should be scalable and suitable for all sizes of companies. That means we are offering stuff for small companies, medium-sized companies, and also big companies. Our business areas are in the area of autonomous and cyber-physical systems, digital services, defense, and e-government. As you see the pictures on the right, our headquarters is in Kaiserslautern. We have also an office in Berlin, and we have an institute in Maryland, CESE, which is counted to the Fraunhofer USA. What are we offering can be distributed in three parts. On the one hand, we have the efficient engineering solutions. That means we are doing engineering activities for companies and also training such stuff. We are very proud for our Rapid Innovation Lab, where we try to create new innovations, starting with creativity workshops and bring it until some prototype or some technology. And we have also the capabilities at our institute to have the creativity rooms, for example, but also the equipment for developing some technology very fast. And as Fraunhofer, of course, we have this independent analysis and assessment of solutions, this 360-degree diagnostic centers. Yeah, our institute stands for the Scalable Software and Systems Engineering. We would like to guarantee quality in the software systems to provide at the end some software-enabled innovations. And what you see on the triangles is also the departments. Here we have departments for this engineering activities like requirements engineering, data engineering, architecture, but also the qualities such as safety, security, and user experience. Maybe one comment to the qualities. What we see at the moment is that the qualities are growing together. Yeah, that means you have to solve safety and security issues together, or challenges, and also security and user experience must be solved together. And that cannot be seen as separated qualities. Let's have a look what is data usage control about. When we see today how we would like to solve data control in the context of the digital transformation, and I would like to start with an illustration. We have nowadays a lot of companies and maybe clients which exchange data together. And the companies are doing business by exchanging data. Clients are sending data to companies to make some business with them, and so on. And everybody in his role here has some demands how the data is processed at the premises of the company. For example, if you say, okay, we have a lot of customer data and you would like to analyze this customer data, then the user has to give consent that the data is analyzed. If the user has not given any consent, then the data must be anonymized before sharing. That means there's a usage restriction which says, okay, if consent is given, I can use the data. If no consent is given, I'm only allowed to use the anonymized data. In the business-to-business area, you have, of course, to exchange some data for doing business. And you maybe demand that data has to be deleted after a certain amount of time. Yeah, when we have this example of the supplier here who sends some data to some manufacturer and says, okay, I can give you the data, but the data should be deleted after 3 days. Also very interesting, this law enforcement agencies and examples here, there the data control is handled on a very fine-grained manner. Yeah, that means you have attributes. And on this attributes level, you have to specify who's allowed to access the data. There are also some very fine-grained stuff, which context and who's allowed to access this. Is the federal state allowed to access the data, or is the BKA allowed to access the data, and so on. And for private persons, also interesting to look in the direction of the energy provider, which says, okay, I can maybe optimize your energy consumptions, but for optimizing your energy consumption, I need to know how you're using the heating equipment, for example, and when you're at home and so on. And this is also personally related information, which that means the processing of the data has to comply with the GDPR, and for providing such added values, you have to give consent. Problem is nowadays that most of the companies try to solve such stuff or such data control with access control. Yeah, this is an established security measure, and but it's not really, really flexible. And when you see that we can create such role-based access control, for example, but usually you have only this yes and no decisions. We have at the moment a transition from this access control to this attribute access control. That means I would like to integrate more information in my decision making. For example, where is the person at the moment located? Is he in the office or is he at home? Is he traveling, for example? Are the security policies up to date in the systems? What kind of devices used to access the data? And so on. But we still allow only this binary decisions. Where we have to go to is to get more flexibility, to have this attribute-based usage control, that you say, okay, I have, of course, on the left side, all these attributes I have to check and so on, but I also would like to control the data when it's used, not when the data is accessed, and to have it more fine-grained. Yeah, it's allowed, but I would be informed when my data is used, or no, it's not allowed, and so on. That means I have increased complexity on the left side and on the right side. And with our usage control solutions, we try to solve this complexity stuff in there. To sum it up, the solution is to get in the direction of data sovereignty and this flexible data control. What you need for this digital transformation is to move from access control to usage control. That means you want to grant and control the data usage based on this context. This is the left side, the current location, role of the user, previous events, for example, and so on. But you also would like to express obligations, time-based, amount-based obligations, for example, and you also need this modification and filtering of data that you can say, okay, on this situation, data has to be anonymized because I'm sharing this data now with third parties or something like this. So far for the usage control in general, and I will have a short look what we are doing at our institute in the area of usage control. The research topic is not new for us. We have activities in the area of data usage control since 10 years now. We introduced at our institute integrated distributed data usage control enforcement. The IDUCE acronym stands for this abbreviation. And we labeled our activities in the area of the IDUCE framework, for example, IDUCE security, IDUCE for Android, IDUCE for the cloud, IDUCE for the, the enterprise service bus and our activities. We achieved a scientific impact. We have more than 44 scientific publications in this area, 15 finished student theses, some are still working at the moment. We have more than 15 research projects in the area of data usage control. We have about 15 with main contribution in data usage control. In others, we are more applying our technology to solve, for example, privacy issues or flexible data control. We have two ongoing PhDs in there. This context of cyber security and the policy specification, or better, the user-friendly policy specification. And in 2014, we have been awarded with the IATA Innovation Prize for a technology which can have huge impact on Europe in the next years. I will shortly go through some of the projects we have. We have the data usage control for the financial sector, where we protect end user data and corporate IP of the banking, for example. We have at our institute data usage control to enforce our information classification. That means how data is handled when it's classified as confidential, internal or public, that you're maybe not allowed to share confidential data or not allowed to print the data. We have some distributed data analysis for the industry 4.0, named the ProOp project in this area. Some enterprise service bus integration for enterprise software solutions. Also very interesting is this ambient assisted living, where we control, for example, the mobile devices of the caretaker and what kind of data is allowed to be seen or not to be seen when they're visiting persons at home, that they, for example, can see all the data when they're at the patient or at the person at home, but not when they are again at home or at some other person and so on. And we spent quite some effort in the area of mobile device management, Android security and so on. To sum it up, a lot of activities which happened already in the last year in the area of data usage control at our institute. Would also have a short look at the differentiation between our induced research and the My Data Control technologies. We are still researching in this area. That means we have research activities, which is branded with this induced research. There we are using our induced framework, and we are using the component names as they are known from the research community, such as the policy enforcement point, the policy decision point, and so on. And here we are also digging into new topics to improve our induced framework, such as the user-friendly policy specification, how policies must be negotiated when you have different solutions to enforce the policies, but also machine learning to classify, for example, data in an automatic manner. And on the other hand, we have the My Data Control technologies, mainly the technology development. There we changed the terminology a little bit. We say, okay, we instead of saying policy decision point, for example, we say rule engine. We have the security policies. We have plugins instead of policy enforcement point, and we have policy editor and so on. And there we have also the open source software development kit to integrate our solution into existing software and systems. And we have the decision and management service, which is at the moment closed source from our side. Yeah, our My Data Control technologies has three main parts. We have on the one hand the enforcement at runtime. That means how to technically enforce these usage restrictions. That means we integrate into a system and then can filter and mask data on the fly or on transit. And you can also do some triggering of additional actions with our components. But Andreas will tell more in detail soon. Okay, and of course we have the policies. That means we have to express our usage restrictions, that you can say, okay, data can only be used 5 times in 24 hours. Here we are expressing cardinality and then time-based capabilities of our language. Or some simple policies such as data must be anonymized before shared with third parties. And the last big part is the management. We have a central administration where we have the policies, the policy management, the component management, the policy editor, user management, and so on and so on. This is in a short explanation what is my data control technologies about. At this point, I would like to hand over to Andreas, who will explain what are our activities in the data usage control in the EDS, and mainly with the two topics, the data sovereignty language and the technologies.
So thank you, Christian. In the following slides, I want to explain or show the language approaches and technologies we use for data sovereignty in the industrial data space. But before we dive deep in to this topic, I want to give a short overview about the data use control activities we have in the industrial data space. We have basically two streams. One stream is concerned with developing a language for specification of data sovereignty requirements. Yeah, this should be, as nature of industrial data space is, technology independent. And on the other hand, we have some development going on to develop active technologies which implement these data sovereignty requirements. So basically, we have some big formalization that can be parted into technical enforcement, organizational rules, and legal contracts. Legal contracts and organizational rules are necessary because not everything can be technically enforced in the system. But our way is just depicted in the lower bottom of the slides. So we're starting without the industrial data space, without having technical enforcement, usage control in it, and have only organizational rules and legal contracts. And the way we want to go with the industrial data space is to incorporate more and more technical enforcement into the system so that we can reduce the amount of organizational rules and legal contracts. To explain that a little bit more and in detail, I show you some example. Real-world example of data usage control we'll call supply chain risk management. In this scenario, two parties are involved. For example, a supplier and original equipment manufacturer both need to exchange data in order to manage their risks, and both also have some data usage requirements that must be fulfilled. Here in this picture, we see the solution without industrial data space. So we have no usage control in place. And the requirements they have are, for example, that the data should only be used by a certain system, and data should be deleted after a couple of days. Yeah. And without usage control in place, this enforcement relies completely on organizational rules and legal contracts. But if you mistake, someone forgets to delete the data, they are still there, yeah, and it's hard to track this data down. So if you now use the data connectors from data from industrial data space, there's also usage control built in. So you have a basic security here, so you can maybe ensure which system is getting the data. But as you can also see in this picture, it is not possible to protect the data when they flow out of the connector. And we'll talk about that a little bit later. So what we implemented in the industrial data space connectors is a policy enforcement point, which is able to intercept the data traffic between connectors. We have a policy decision point that is that contains all the rules and the policies for the data. And we have some execution point that is able to delete data, for example, or have comments and actions in place. So if we now want to control the data a little bit more, then we have to look at this picture. So in this picture, we depicted how maximum stage of usage control enforcement can look like. So basically, you need to spread create an ecosystem and need to spread the policy enforcement points everywhere so that you can control the data flow from one customer to the other customer at the client desktop. So this comes, of course, not free. So you have to implement a lot, and we'll talk about this in the following slides. Means if you want to have a high impact, if you want to have a high data sovereignty, you also have a high impact on your system. So if you implement it, for example, only in the IDS connector, your your possible control over data sovereignty is limited. If you want a full control of data sovereignty, you have to implement in every system that is connected to the data or is using the data. So our next topic will be the language for the specification of data sovereignty. As I already said, we aim for technology-independent formalization of the data sovereignty requirements. And as we already have an information model in place, our approach is to include these usage restrictions as part of the metadata in this information model. So in this information model, we describe all the data that is transferred. And with this description, there comes also this usage restrictions. To describe these usage restrictions, we agreed on using Open Digital Rights Language, ODRL, and extended it and adjusted it so that it fits our needs. This declarative specification level policies need to be refined to technology dependent policies, because this specification level policies are not really technology dependent, cannot be enforced by our systems. Here's an example of an ODL policy. So basically use ODL policy as a language that provides flexible information model for representing statements about the usage of content and services. In the policy you see below, it specifies an ODL offer policy that allows an action of reading a target asset until a certain time. What you also can see is that you can specify constraints with Boolean and logical operations, and target and designer are identified via URIs. But you don't have to specify it like that. Only in text, we will provide you with an editor that allows you to create this in a more or less easy way for you. So in order to come to technology-dependent policies, we're currently developing some semi-automated process for the policy specification. And our approach is here to look at all the usage scenarios we have from our customers and the companies we work with, and have a look at the data sovereignty requirements in this usage, in these use cases, and collect all these regulations. We then extracted all the classes of policies we possibly have in there. So we want to narrow down some, we want to start up from a small set of possible policies and increase it later on. We also created then technology independent policies for all these classes, and also technology dependent policies in our example in the MyData language. And we then use templates to generate policies in an easy way and map this data to our language policies. I show you this in a short example for a better understanding. So we have again such an ODRL policy I already showed to you, like this one. Here we want to allow an ODRL action on a certain target asset before and after a certain date and time. So we came up with such an ODRL template. And what you need to do is you have to fill out some actions. So what you want to do, for example, read, an asset UUID to identify the data, and you also have to add the time date constraints, for example. After that, you have a valid ODRL policy that can be transferred to our My Data policy in more or less easy way. And it looks quite easy, but in the end, it's not that easy process. As with every language, you have the possibility to express the same in different ways. Next up, I want to talk about the technical implementation of data sovereignty in the industrial data space. Fraunhofer offers various technologies in the industrial data space, for example, data usage control in use and My Data Control technology. There is also a technology called label-based usage control in industrial data space. It will be presented by Gerd Groß later on. We also offer some information tracking, information flow tracking, and data provenance solution in industrial data space. So the difference between those two technologies is that data usage control is mostly used to enforce provisions and obligations across system boundaries, and to be able to have a runtime monitoring and enforcement through policy enforcement points. So it's proactive technology. Obligations and future constraints must be implemented by policy execution points so that you're able to delete, notify, and log stuff. Data provenance tracking, on the other hand, is recording the history of data flows and data usages. So they want to answer the question from where the data is coming, where did it flow to, where has it been processed, and who processed it. So it's more about the retro perspective. Applications of this technology are, for example, data protection, so transparency and right of information, and also traceability, so which data has been included in a calculation, for example. Now I want to show you the details of our implementation of data sovereignty with my data control technologies. We offer basically three kinds of plugins in our open source SDK. One is for data modification. Yeah, so we are able to modify data streams and requests based on active rule set. For example, remove all customer data customer addresses before releasing data to external parties. And this is done by this red component you see, policy enforcement point. We also can execute actions, as I already said. Yeah, this can be compensatory actions or additional actions based on the active rule set. For example, whenever somebody logs into a system, notify me via email. This is done by the policy execution point. On the other hand, the third plugin is information resolution. So you can enhance the policy decisions by adding more information to it, like, for example, if the user has the role risk manager or if the user is located in his office. So you can there add every external information source, like a directory server or a GPS device, for example. In the lower part of this picture, you see a policy management point, for example. It provides you with administration views, dashboard, some components list policies, and you can also configure time-based events. It offers you a policy editor for developers. You can see client-specific logs, and you have a user and application management. The policy decision point, on the other hand, guarantees a scalable policy evaluation at runtime. So all the policies you specify are in there and will be considered if some event is coming in. And this is what I show you on this slide, on the next slide, how this is technically done. So if you want to integrate a policy enforcement point, you just consider, for example, a method where data is flowing through and you add one line in there that calls our framework method and generates some event. Yeah, this event is processed by the policy decision point and based on the currently active rule set. And he gives back some authorization decision that states if data should be now aggregated or modified or something like that. You basically want to implement this policy enforcement point everywhere where you use person-related data or where you aggregate data, for example. Or data can only be used for specific purposes. I now extended the picture a little bit to show you the use of the policy information point and the policy execution point. So if an event is coming in to the policy decision point based on the active rule set, you can also request additional information from a policy information point. So for example, it can connect to an LDAP and retrieve some system specific roles for user ID, or it can get the current geolocation of a mobile phone. And the policy execution point can be used, for example, to log data or to inform a data owner. So next up is Gerd Prost. He will present some more information about label-based usage control. So I guess, Gerd, are you here?
Yes, thank you very much. Hi. I just had to dial in because my audio connection isn't, my internet and audio connection isn't really that good. But let's try to take this over. Hi, can you hear me?
We can hear you.
Ah, okay. Great. So, okay, so thank you. As for the motivational slides, I believe most of the stuff has already been said by Christian and Andreas. We believe that in IoT scenarios and also in the industrial data space, we need some kind of new paradigm for data security, because the current models where we have local data processing and fixed data processing routes, for example, are not adequate anymore, because we are getting more dynamic data flows and more processing over various trust and security domains, which is like the story of the IDS. Could you go one slide forward, please? So we believe that classical perimeter protection and access control is not enough anymore, and it's basically the same what has been said before. So what we want to achieve is we want to really take a look on the data flows themselves. We want to make sure that we are able to control these kind of data flows. And for example, since we have a combination of different new data sources, we get a lot of new challenges, like we care for personal data, and we have to take care of that. And also, if we have data flows over different trust domains, we need, for example, trusted audit logging, for example, where it's really possible to trace where information that's going to be a trading good in the future has been used for a specific purpose. So next slide, please. So if we take a look at this example, this is tough because this is like animated. So could you please step to the end of the animation, because then it's okay. Thank you very much. So if we're taking a look at this kind of logistics use case, where we have, for example, a truck that has a driver, he's loading parcels, for example, he has location information where he's currently at and where he's headed to. We have the idea of the vehicle, we have the idea of the driver, for example. We want to track that, because we want to know where the truck is currently at, where the parcels are, if he had a breakdown or something like that. But if you combine these kind of data sources, we kind of generate personal information, because by combining these data sources, gets a legal problem, and we have to care for that. So if we transmit that with our system, it's possible to add labels to specific data streams and to data itself. So here we can say, okay, by combining that, it transformed to personal information. So we can attach this label, and if we transmit to some IDS connector or some cloudified or some centralized data processing node, for example, we have this label, and with that we know that it's personal information, for example. And we want to make sure that we specify policies that this personal information may not be externalized to other sources, for example, that are not under our control. So we can specify properties to services, saying that if we have, for example, an anonymizer service, that we can remove a certain part of the data and make sure that it's not personal anymore. So if we define a data route where we aggregate and anonymize before, then we have something that is just an anonymized part without driver and personal information anymore. And this is okay to externalize that. And what we are able to do is we can specify policies and node properties in a way that this can be achieved. And with these anonymized paths, for example, we can safely forward this to external stakeholders and let the data be processed. So the next slide, please. Thank you very much. What we do is we call our system Lucon, which is label-based usage control, and this is what I just showed, that we try to have a very simple system where it's possible to attach properties to, or we define service properties in this language, and also to attach labels to data. And by adding and removing this kind of data, we can define data flows and policies and rules that shape how this data is processed. So if we want to achieve some security requirements or data protection goals, then we can specify something like this rule down there, where we can say, for example, when, and it's not an if, it's in when, because we also think in a kind of temporal constraint, data is transmitted to a service that is not in our domain, for example, and there we transmit personal information, for example, containing vehicle or account data. Then we can just decide to drop the data so it may not be externalized. So just a very simple example, but it's supposed to show how we can work with this kind of labels. So next slide, please. What we try to achieve is with this language on the right, I just showed you a flow rule, and but we also have this kind of service properties where we can say what kind of endpoint, for example, create labels that are attached to the data. We try to support the users by having a domain specific language accompanied by an editor, where you have like auto completion, where you have like user guidance. We compile the policies into a logical formula, but the user doesn't see that, and it's all done in the background, and you just see the domain specific language, which has the goal to make this very easy. And we are also having the goal to have ODRL automatically transmitted to kind of DSL, but we're still working on that. So these compiled policies are then transmitted to the another gateway and enforced on this point. What we want to achieve is to have a very simple system where it's possible that we say, okay, I have defined my data routes and my data flows, and I want to have the information. Is it possible that my configuration exposes personal data, for example? So we have some kind of information generation where we can say, for an administrator, is my data policy breaking any kind of rules? And what we want to achieve is that we have like a double check against misconfiguration, for example. So if an administrator is setting up its routes, we implemented it with Camel currently, but you can transfer that to other systems as well. Then the administrator gets information if the routes configured achieve certain data protection goals, for example, or if they violate any kind of rules we put into the system. And we use model checking for that, because what I just said, we translate this DSL into a formula, and we are have an automatic validation of dynamic data routes for that. Next slide, please. Thank you very much. This is our part.
Okay, thank you, Gerd, for presenting the label-based usage control and the details about it. And thank you, Andreas, for the My Data Control technologies. These are two technologies which are for the enforcement, for the proactively interacting with the data flow and preventing or not preventing some flows in the system. The data provenance tracking, or the information flow tracking I present now, is the retrospective part. That means this technology is not enforcing stuff. It's more the collection and what's happened in the system. And the idea is here to collect and log all the transactions which happened in the system, for the data flows and how the data usages happened in the systems, and to store them in a distributed storage for this provenance data. to ensure the privacy and availability of the data. And the data owner should always be capable to see some aggregated and visualized information about how the data is flown. For this illustration here, the idea is to integrate such technologies in the connectors. That means where the data is flowing, and then we have this small tree structures there, which illustrates how the data is flowed in the system and how the data is maybe distributed in the system, copied and so on. And this is then aggregated with this provenance collection to this provenance privacy dashboard. And what you see on the screenshot is then here to say, okay, I can see that my data has been flown from one company to another company, and for example, to PayPal in this example here, or some other companies. And then you can say, okay, my credit card information was shared with this company and was used at this premises, and so on and so on. From a more technical perspective, we have the policy enforcement points, as the colleagues presented, which are integrated in the connector, and they are also providing this flow information to the data flow tracking and provenance storage, which is done locally, but they, of course, have to transfer this data to a central provenance collection to provide this privacy dashboard. And on this picture, the architecture, high-level architecture is presented, how this is integrated in the system, and that you can see on a central instance how the data is used. Yeah, for what can you use the data provenance technology? Of course, if you think about the law, the GDPR, it's about the data protection rights of the data subject. They have the right to access the data by the subject, and for this you have to know where the data is stored. Also for the right to be forgotten, if you have to delete all the data, then you must know where the data has been flown in the system, that you can be sure to delete all the stuff. And of course, you need it also for the right to data portability, that you know where you have to fetch the data for some person, for example. And of course, the logging of the data flows and the usages can be used as a proof of compliance. Yeah, in some audit log, for example, that you can guarantee or provide this information. If you have some calculation in the system or made some decisions based on data, you can also use it for this traceability and verification. Yeah, that you say, okay, which data has been used, and this data is really originating from this data source and has been used for this calculation, or to calculate the results which have been a decision to do anything in the system. And of course, you can use it for clearing and billing of data usages. Yeah, I use the data 5 times, for example, can just be monitored by such a data provenance tracking technology. Let's come to the summary, further information and contact persons. What we stated is that access control is not sufficient to have this comprehensive and flexible data control. And data usage control is a building block for data, for solving our data sovereignty challenges. And what we presented is that we have different technologies in the IDS which cope with these challenges. We have the two enforcement technologies and also the provenance technology to monitor to monitor the data. On the other hand, we are working in the area of the data sovereignty language. That means we are formalizing the data sovereignty requirements, that you can say, okay, I have my usage restrictions and they have to be somehow formalized, that also other parties or companies that would like to make business with them can understand them. And they are the basis for a trustworthy data exchange and all data usage control technologies. Yeah, that means maybe there's also some independent of Fraunhofer developed technology which fulfills then this language and can process it at the end. I would like to have here a final takeaway message. It was in our beginning of the presentation with the stages of usage control enforcement. If you would like to have a comprehensive data sovereignty, then of course you have to change stuff in your system. And it's always a trade-off between the enforcement capabilities and the effort you're willing to spend at the end to realize this here. I put here some links for further information for my data control technologies, the website, developer website, source code binaries, the induced research website, the Lucun documentation, and also our usage control in the industrial data space document, which you can directly access on Jive. Here are the contact persons for the My Data Control Technologies. It's Andreas Eitel and Christian Jung, that's me. And the data provenance activities are handled by Fraunhofer IOSP in Karlsruhe. Your first contact person is Pascal Birnstill. And for the label-based usage control and other security-related activities in the IDS, it's Gerd Prost from the Fraunhofer ISEC in Munich or Garching. That's the end of our presentations. And yeah, of course, we are happy to answer your questions or discuss about the topic. Are there questions? Okay, if there are no further questions, I would like to hand over again to Sebastian Steinbus. Okay, it seems that our moderator has some technical problems. I hope that the others are still in the conference.
Yeah. Hello, Christian. I'm sorry, I had some audio issues, so couldn't call in. Yes, Jaroslav Bullman from Fit. I would be quite interesting whether there's an overview or maybe a new code of callback or interfaces for integrating the components you presented, PEP, for example, or decision point, information point, with external systems. This is quite important, for example, when relying on external enforcement capabilities, like delegating the deletion of data in a database to SAP or whatever. So would we, as users of Indus and My Data Technologies, find somewhere guidance on which interfaces should be implemented in order to integrate with Indus and My Data?
Okay, thank you, Jan, for the question. As you presented, we have developed this software development kit, which is open source, and the software development kit encapsulates all the plugins, which are named the policy enforcement point, the policy information point, and the policy execution point. And yeah, there the interfaces are standardized from our side. That means if you implement it, then you use a standardized interface from our side, and also the communication to the policy decision point and management point are standardized. And you can directly see them on the developer webpage in our documentation. But for developers, it's maybe better to directly dig into the open source code and see how this is handled in there. That means our software development kit is created in a way that you can directly use it and integrate it. And yeah, most of the stuff is hidden for the developer. And as Andreas said, it's mainly, yeah, it's one line in the code, and you have to specify your interface, how you would like to use it, but that's really it. And everything else is hidden at the end then.
Mm-hmm. Very good, thank you. So I will look at how to integrate in terms of these interfaces. Thanks.
Further questions?
If may, I have a further question. I'm just wondering how activities which are deferred, which sometimes need time, I don't know whether they could be supported because they really may block an interaction like payments or whatever is sort of decoupled from the actual data interactions. Like this data may be communicated, maybe used when or in case 5 euros have been paid. Is the payment and then knowing of or on identifying payment, for example, the event of being some amount being paid, how this is done by the information policy information point? This is part of the context, and so should such information or provision be integrated with in-use, or are there some plugins for external systems?
Yeah, that is a good question. I think as the payment is not directly part of the decision engine, we would connect such information with the policy information point interface and then say, okay, the data would now be used and dear policy information point, please give me the information if for this data item with this ID the payment happened. And with such policy information point, you can of course also make some counting how often such data is created. And I think that this is your question. And the other is the time-based activities. This depends a little bit on how you would like to solve the time-based activities. When it's just for the data transfer, you would do it directly in the rule. If you make some obligations, such as you have to delete the data, then you of course have to interact maybe with some other systems or integrate it into database. Yeah, or to say, okay, after 14 days, I have to trigger the database that or the file system to delete the data.
Mm-hmm. And for example, in case of payment, then the evaluation would be on hold or would be paused for some time until a confirmation of payment arrived, because then the event is communication could start. No, it could not, because we wait for a payment event or payment confirmation, and then I think the decision will be deferred until the conditions, the context has been completed, or the information has arrived. Yeah. So there's
the condition is met, and if the condition is not met, in our case, would the condition be a payment? Could also be something else. But if this is not met, then of course the data transfer is not allowed, or the data use at the end.
Okay, can you hear me again? I had some audio problems recently.
Yeah, you're back, Sebastian.
Yeah, sorry for that. Yes. So, yes, again, thank you for the very interesting webinar. Any other questions? Yahoo, do you have another question or anyone else?
Not really question, but this, sometimes having a technology which is demanding, which is new, it may help to create a community around. So you have already open source software. It might be interesting and in looking at, for example, to have a repository of example policies and somehow relating them to problems to solved. So this would be, I think, very helpful for newbies when adopting usage of in-use in their systems. So maybe ask for and look, evaluate what you have done, provide some anonymized examples of rules which might be of interest. I have not so far looked at under this code base, but this would be helpful for anybody looking for introduction to your system, such a collection of examples.
Mm-hmm. Okay, we have some technology specific policies, of course, with our open source stuff. We have on the one hand the software development kit we presented, but we have also some demo examples as open source which you can look at and implemented by your own some services, and then you have web UI where you can maybe transfer some data, and there are also some policies included. Mm-hmm. This is on the one hand, and on the other hand is that we have our activities for this policy classes, where we said, okay, these are the main classes of policies we have at the moment, which we collected within the IDS and also with other potential customers we discussed on a high level basis and tried to transfer them to the ODRL, and then said also, okay, from this ODRL we need some technology or technology dependent representation, and this is ongoing work, but I think it's worth to publish this stuff.
This is exactly what I meant, because if you look, for example, at ODRL, so there's the documentation of the policy language, but often you have hard time understanding what was meant with particular examples. So to have such a set of concrete policies and explanation to them, then the interpretation is more easier. Otherwise, you have doubts whether you've understood and interpreted particular statements in a correct way. And looking at code would be helpful in any sense. Thanks.
Thank you, Jaro, for your question.
So, okay, then thank you again, all the presenters for today. Very interesting talk. Thank all the listeners for today, and then I'd like to wish you the best Friday ever, and hope to see you again soon. So thank you again. Goodbye.